We're here to talk about research and scholarly publishing in the age of big data. The three of us here are going to start off just by introducing ourselves and saying why we're interested in this topic. Then I'll come back to how we're going to handle the conversation, and then we'll go on from there. So my name is Ziyad Marar. I'm the Global Publishing Director at Sage and have been at Sage a long time doing various things, but more latterly have been very interested in what the sort of big data revolution means for social research in particular, and why it's such a struggle in various areas of the social sciences to really respond to the opportunity. So I'll be talking a bit about that later on in the session. Let me then have Fran and Ian introduce themselves. So, Fran.
Great. Hello, everyone. My name is Fran Bennett, and I'm here from the slightly different world of big data practitioners. So I run a company called Mastodon C, and what we do is bring the tools and techniques of big data to bear on the problems of interesting organizations. So those of us who founded the company are from a background of consumer internet and finance, and realized that the tools and technologies of making sense of data and finding insight in data were getting really good. There's a lot of data about, there was a lot of potential for impact, and we thought it was kind of a waste to spend it, all of that resource, on getting people to click on ads more or making a little bit more money for an investment bank. So we now run a company that uses those same approaches to try and solve more interesting and important problems in the world with more interesting and important clients, as we see it, like publishers.
Hello, I'm Ian Mulvany. I spent probably the last 10 years working on different products and services in the publishing academic space. A few years ago, I was head of product at Mendeley, and while I was there, I was product managing a product that involved some of the big data analytics that Mendeley was starting to get working with and tried to sell that into the library market. The last 4 years, I've been head of technology at an open access journal called eLife, and there we face questions around how a journal can integrate with data, how much data is it easy to publish, how do you reference or cite data. In the course of my work there, I got involved with a few working groups giving some advice to the European Commission. So I've just written a short paper on challenges to data sharing for the European Commission. As of 2 weeks ago, I'm very delighted now to be head of product innovation at Sage with a very specific remit to try and understand the big data challenges in emerging fields in social sciences and in computational social science, and to try to think about what the role of a publisher like Sage might be to help with those nascent fields and see if there are kinds of tools or services that we could create that can help in that marketplace.
Great. So you know where we're coming from and why we're here. So in terms of what we're going to do, I think the big data conversation is one that's both sort of fresh and compelling and hackneyed and everyday at the same time. So we are kind of now dwarfed by these extraordinary numbers and yet find them pretty much commonplace. People mention 1.5 billion people on Facebook. 650 million blogs were written today. There are about 40,000 Google searches per second. And the most striking thing about these extraordinary numbers is they've become cliches. We've actually got used to it very, very fast. So one way or another, we are drenched and undoubtedly in a world of big data. And obviously some say this is a cause for great alarm. Quite often a phrase is used about the business model of the internet being surveillance. And it was actually, Fran here is reading this book by Cathy O'Neill that's just come out, called Weapons of Math Destruction, subtitle, How Big Data Increases Inequality and Threatens Democracy. And a book that's actually just been reviewed by Kent Anderson today in Scholarly Kitchen. And Kent, I think, is in the room somewhere. So no doubt, as we get into discussion, those themes may come back. So clearly, there are people who are hand-wringing about the worries of big data, and they have their reasons, no doubt. There are also the boosterists, the people who are incredibly excited by the potential of what big data can offer, and who are using it busily one way or another. People who see this as a sort of pivotal moment in human history where we can get a level of understanding of what it is to be human, ways to improve society and culture in a way that's never been seen before. And that's sort of another end of the spectrum, but love it or loathe it, we are no doubt drenched, but not to equal degree. So I'm very fond of a line from the cyberpunk novelist William Gibson, who once said, the future has arrived, it's just unevenly distributed. And I think when it comes to the question of big data and its impacts on different sectors and areas, that's incredibly obviously true. And I think that is going to be one of the ways we work through this discussion through this afternoon. So we're talking about sort of breaking the discussion up into four broad areas. We're going to start out by talking about the use of big data in the sort of company and corporate sector. And Fran is going to lead us out on that and sort of give us a bit of her perspective and experience and in her background in that area. And we'll sort of trigger a conversation there. After we've gone around that topic, we'll move then into science and the way science and research has been impacted by the big data opportunity. And Ian will lead us out on that one, which will then lead us on to a conversation about social research, which is an area very close to my heart, but is very obviously profoundly relevant in a day and age where most of those numbers I've quoted are about social media chucking out vast amounts of data relevant to human behavior, which social researchers do need to get their teeth into. And then we'll kind of come fully back then to the question of what does it mean for the sort of scholarly publishing system? What do we as organizations, as an industry, need to do to place ourselves well in that context, whether it's around threats, opportunities, barriers to entry, and so on, or even just the sheer mission of what it is that we're in business to do. So hopefully those four areas will give us enough of the structure to work our way through. That said, there will be overlapping themes. We will no doubt go forward and back. And I would like to see if we can get some participation along the way, maybe like towards the end of each of these four sessions. I'll sort of open up and see what questions people have. I'll also be following the ALPS hashtag on Twitter as we go, and so it may well be I can see some of the things you're thinking about or wondering about, and I'll pick them up here and throw them into the conversation. So with that preamble generally, let's start with the first topic area, which is the company corporate context in which big data are used. Fran.
Thank you. So I just wanted to set a little bit of context first, because a conversation that I very often have is about whether big data is basically hype and nonsense. Is this just an exciting term that lets people sell more services? The truth is, in some ways, yes, big data has been a convenient label to attach to things to make them sound more new and exciting. But there are some real shifts which are a good fundamental reason why the corporate world has been getting very excited about the use of data for a few years, and why now other areas are also getting much more excited about it. So there are a few fundamental things that have changed. So first up, there is a lot more data about. So big data, we hear about a lot about the general scale of data that's around. Obviously, just amounts of data by themselves are not particularly interesting, but the amount of different types of data which are now generated cheaply and easily changes the amount of material available for whatever problem you're trying to solve. So thinking about something like the telephone in your pocket, that's collecting and generating data all the time in the background. That is a worry from a surveillance point of view, but that's also very interesting from a potential insight point of view. And both of those things are very important. So there's much more data available, much more cheaply. Second, being able to handle that data has become also much cheaper and more available. I won't bore you with the technical details, but basically the search engines about 12 years ago invented some distributed data processing technologies, which mean that where you used to have to buy one supercomputer to deal with a large amount of data, you can now have a set of very cheap I'm trying to think of a polite word, not very good servers, which you orchestrate to act like a supercomputer. And services like Amazon Web Services will rent you those very cheaply. So you can rent a fleet of cheap machines for pennies per hour to process unlimited amounts of data. So you've got loads of data material, you have got a cheap and easy way of processing lots of it. The third major factor is that the algorithms to make sense of that data are becoming codified clearly and simply in various libraries. So we haven't invented new types of maths, or not many new types of maths, but the types of maths which have existed for several decades are much, much easier to apply than they were a few years ago. So we've got tools to make sense of data, we've got processing power very cheaply to process it, and we've got material to work with. Those three factors coming together are the reason that the corporate world is looking around to see how they can take advantage of this set of circumstances coming together. And as the price drops and drops, the areas of interest increase. So where a couple decades ago, perhaps Tesco Club Card made economic sense, the cost of collecting and processing that data made sense for Tesco. Now you can be a much smaller or much less profitable retailer and still think in the same way as Club Card in terms of trying to get and use customer data to optimize things. The prize doesn't have to be as big. Your confidence in whether it will work doesn't have to be as great. So that there are just new things you can do. So that's why it's interesting. There are some very standard things that most businesses will do. So to give you one example from a corporate client we work with, they're a large business-to-business retailer. They've got lots of customers. Those customers occasionally leave them. That makes our client very sad because they have to then get new customers. So for them, we run what's a very bread and butter system for data analysts, a predictive system which every day goes through all their customer data and says who's likely to leave them in the next month. So taking lots and lots of different signals from what they've bought, how they've acted, who they've talked to, baking all of that together into a single score that says what's the percentage chance that this person is going to go somewhere else. That is completely standard for most retailers, certainly nowadays, and increasingly for any kind of business that has customers that they want to keep. And that set of technologies coming together means that most businesses are able to build a custom system like that with whatever sets of data they particularly have that they could use to make predictions. So that's the sort of standard bread and butter approach that corporates take. As the technology gets better and better, we're also able to do what I would say are some more interesting applications. So to take a different and probably more fun example, we are doing some prototyping work with DEFRA, the Department for Environment, Food and Rural Affairs. Have I got that right? Environment Farming? I always get the acronym wrong. Anyway, the people in charge... They do, yeah. The people in charge of livestock. And they have to look at animal diseases. It's one of their responsibilities. One of the ways they do that is collect lots of post-mortems which get sent into them from vets all over the country. When they find a dead cow, they write up a description of what happened and send that into DEFRA. DEFRA's got a few specialist vets who look at it. They haven't got as many as they would like to read every single post-mortem. They haven't got endless memories to file away every detail of where things happen and how things happen. So sometimes patterns can get missed until they're very, very obvious. So the work we're doing there is dealing with that unstructured text data and getting computers to detect apparent patterns in sets of words that are starting to appear together in unusual ways or things that are happening in unusual places, and just setting off an alert to focus those experts' attention on the few postmortems that seem to be odd or unusual or special, so that those rare experts' time can be focused on exactly the right thing. So that's an example of using machine learning to deal with a fairly messy pile of data, structure it into a way that that lets you use expert humans in a very targeted way and lets those humans really focus on the highest value things they can do. So more and more uses like this are opening up, particularly in text detection, which I think are making things very interesting for also industries like publishing. And Ian, I think you wanted to talk about science.
I think you're going to counter. We'll come back on this.
Yes, before I talk about science, I'd say, I mean, a lot of those applications that Fran was talking about are clearly, obviously, of value and utility to those industries. But how does that reflect back on our industry? And just purely from the point of view of how we operate as an industry in an increasingly technologically oriented world, I think there are kind of three things I wanted to touch on there. I think for sure content and high quality content is the bread and butter of what we do in this industry, but it's all mediated through software. It's all mediated through digital systems. Marc Andreessen has this great quote from many years ago, almost 10 years ago now, I think, called "Software is eating the world." And if you don't become a technologically competent organization those organizations that are in your competitor pool who are will eat your lunch, and particularly ones who may even be coming from a scale or a size that you hadn't previously considered. And we saw many examples of that in the keynote earlier. And so I think STM has many of these kinds of internal questions that are of extreme relevance, questions like customer retention, questions like who are the authors that are going to get a lot of attention, questions like how are our billing systems working, are they working efficiently, how are our production systems working, are they working efficiently. So I think if we cracked open the machines of how our publishing organizations worked, there are many, many opportunities there to apply these techniques, to gain insight, to improve the businesses that as they're operating today. But more than that, finding and hiring and retaining key technical talent, I think, is going to be a critical determiner of how well our organizations operate. And it's hard. It's hard to hire in scholarly publishing when scholarly publishing tends to be based in centers like London or New York or San Francisco, and you're competing against organizations like Mastodon C, and you're competing against the Googles and the Facebooks. And so having projects that people can work on that are interesting, being open to try and hire for those projects, and trying to combine that with the sorts of missions that our organizations have, I think are ways to get over the difficulty in hiring. And that's something I've certainly experienced in my last role at eLife. I would say that the data that we would look at internally in procedural operational data in publishing is probably not, quote unquote, big data. But one of the things I think is really fascinating about the big data movement is it has made skills available in the marketplace and made a whole new cohort of people who operate with those skills, the data scientist, a new discipline. And you don't need to have massive data to apply those skills to get value. And so a kind of side effect of all of this massive data at scale is new disciplines have emerged and new ways of working with messy heterogeneous data has emerged. Data science as a term was originally coined in 1974 by Peter Neuer, and I've heard it described that a data scientist is just a statistician that works on a Mac, or a data scientist is a statistician that works in San Francisco. But actually, it's more than that. It's actually about how you wrangle data. And I think we're an interesting industry because that wrangling of data and creating high-quality metadata and high-quality underlying structured data is something this industry has been doing for 10, 15 years. But I'd be interested to know how many of you have been taking your entire corpus of content and running it through machine learning algorithms to find patterns. I'd say not a huge number of us, you know. And now, why is that? That's kind of interesting.
And, well, just pause there and ask. Yeah. How many of you have, on any level, sort of try to analyze, you have.
And how many of you have not?
There seems to be a confused,
yeah. Majority not.
Yeah.
And how many of you think it's irrelevant? So that's not the reason for not.
Yeah.
Well, obviously, contact Fran if you need to, and need some professional help.
And I'll mention one last kind of anecdote. I just came across this while reading a blog about value mapping in how technologies evolve over time by a guy called Simon Wardley, who writes really great, brilliantly about this. And he referenced this bloke called Henry Maudsley. And Henry Maudsley has now suddenly become one of my heroes, even though I only found out about him in the last couple of weeks. In 1800, Henry Maudsley invented a lathe that could create nuts and bolts. And before that, every single nut and bolt that was made in the world was handmade. And every single nut would only fit one bolt. And now look around us. We live in a world of commodification. We live in a world of mass production. And until this problem of how you build the tools that build objects that could be mass produced was solved, that was impossible. And we're in this kind of now mixed world with software development where the algorithms and the tooling like TensorFlow, like Amazon's machine learning tool, are beginning to be commodified, but yet the people who are writing the processes that work around those are still doing them by hand. And so I wonder in the next 10 or 20 years, we'll see that change as well. And I don't know the answer to that,
but
I
think it's a... will come with a new lathe.
Yeah, exactly. It's an extremely interesting moment where we all depend on software, but the vast majority of the software we still depend on is handwritten. And that poses... I don't know what to think about that exactly, but I'm endlessly fascinated by it.
So before we turn to the question of how scientists are using big data and I wonder if we should give Cathy O'Neill her due. It's been about sort of up till now we've been talking about what can be done and what the positives are. Are there downsides and worries that merit exploring? Do we need to worry about the fact that people are making black boxes that they don't understand what's inside them and that we are embedding judgments which shape outcomes without realizing? Well, any views on the sort of the dark side? From my
Definitely. I wanted to go back to something that Ian said about, you were saying the data scientist is a statistician with a Mac.
Yeah.
And that there's sometimes a little bit of truth in that. But really, a good data scientist should be a statistician, but also reasonable at programming. But the third thing that sometimes gets lost is that they should be good at understanding the context of what they do.
Yeah.
And in a business situation, that means understanding business value, ROI, not getting... excited about nerding out over their algorithm so much that they forget to make money. But in the social context as well, there's exactly the same thing, is these are really powerful tools. Mm. And a good data scientist doing things that have social impact should be doing accurate algorithms, they should be doing effective high performance programming, but they should also be thinking about what is this thing that I am building? What are the assumptions that I'm encoding? Mm. Does it matter? How am I encoding them? And there are lots of examples in Cathy's book and elsewhere about how people encode things about the history of how things have worked. For example, in policing, in the US, policing is known to be often quite racist, and machine learning systems effectively take how things happen in the past, assume those are correct, and project into the future what's going to happen next. So if you've got a system that's already biased and you create an algorithm to replicate it, it will just replicate the bias of the humans who were previously running the system. That's an important problem.
Pre-crime
idea
is predictive of who might commit crimes could be a massively conservative reinforcement of what are the current assumptions.
Yeah, there are potentially two problems with pre-crime, really. One is perhaps you are incorrectly including, for example, racist assumptions, which may not be accurate, but you may also get really good at genuinely saying who's doing a crime. But do we want to put those kinds of tools in the hands of government? Do we want government to know exactly what your likelihood of committing a crime is, even if it is perfectly accurate? Mm. Is that an acceptable thing to have?
Yes. As opposed to using those tools to discover the underlying reasons why a certain demographic is causing crime and how to solve it at that level, for instance.
I mean, the sad experience is that it was certainly you always hope that by creating more sophisticated tools, enlightened people will then say, I've got some new insight and I'm going to thoughtfully, carefully apply this. And the way it often happens is you have some algorithm which makes a prediction. People say, well, the computer said so we're just going to crack on with that. And it becomes very crude in its application. There's always a risk.
That's a step that the social researchers could fundamentally get into in terms of going beyond atheoretical predictions and actually start to look for explanations. But we'll no doubt come to that kind of stuff.
I mean, I was struck by your comment about how they should also be very aware of the value that they create and what they do. Mm-hmm. And one of my things that I experienced frequently when I was working at Mendeley was the data team. We'd ask, should we track this or should we track that? And the data team were always like, let's track everything. Mm-hmm. Let's track it all because we'll use it at some unspecified time in the future. And while that sentiment is clear, when you're actually making decisions around which piece of engineering to take on right now, if you do that, you're spending money for a deferred potential value in the future. And not maybe optimizing against what's going to create the most value for your organization or for your customer at that moment in time. And so you can end up, I feel, sometimes over-tracking things where it's because it's possible to do so, and as a result, generating a digital exhaust or a digital waste, which has some properties which are a bit like toxic waste, in that they're very hard to extract value from. they sit around forever and nobody knows what to do with it. Mm. And so that question about value and the ethics associated with that value is one that I think is really key to be asked at the very outset before you go down that route of starting to track the data and put it into your data center.
It's a great watchword then against undisciplined hoarding and saying, it's to be systematic is to say what you don't do as well as what you do do.
Yeah. It's hard though, because to just say, oh, let's track everything is so easy. And it leads to those kinds of experiences you have when you install that application which says, sign me up with your Google profile and let me have everything. Mm. And you're like,
doing the tracking in a technical sense is now really easy, and pretty making a hoard is very cheap now.
As we move, as we should, into the science perspective, I imagine you're going to start arguing against yourself in about 5 minutes' time, and I'm looking forward to that moment.
Almost certainly.
Before we do, can I just check if anyone's got any questions at the moment or any comments they'd like to throw in? Yeah.
So the question was, how long do we spend understanding customer needs versus how much time do we spend executing?
Yeah.
It depends on the customer, obviously, but I would say it's critical to have at least a meaty stage of understanding what the customer needs, and or at least extracting from them their existing understanding of what they need, because without that, the technical work is pretty futile, frankly. It's understanding customer need, and also it's quite a cyclical process, this type of development. So a sort of idealized project feels like it would be, you understand the customer need, you go away and build them a magic box that solves their problem, you come back and you say, here's your gift wrapped thing, and it's finished. The reality of how that process tends to work is you understand customer need, you go away and prototype something, bring back what you've found. Customer likes some of it, customer says some of it's not what they need, some new ideas are generated, some things change, you go back, you do something again, you look at it again, you come back. So there's a lot of going back and forth. Also because these systems are often augmenting experts' judgment, the initial stages are often a lot of talking to that expert and saying, this is what a system seems to be saying, does that chime with your expertise, does that surprise you? Does it confirm things that you already suspected, or does it go against them? And really trying to see what's going on there. It's quite an organic thing. It's not just a technical process.
I think we'll move us on to the science bit. I don't see hands jumping up and down, and actually it's probably time we should try and look at how big data is impacting on different sectors within the research world. So Ian, why don't you kick us off on that?
Yeah, okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm just going to have a little chat about how researchers work with data, and I have a little mental model of how I think about how the research community breaks out when you look at them through the lens of data, and I'll talk through that. And then I'll just mention a few, I think, of the current trends we're seeing in the funding landscape and in the technical landscape that might change things. And then I'll probably end with just a couple of questions about what are the needs that we see researchers having in how they deal with data. Because in a way, our industry is one in which we're trying to find solutions to those needs, but you have to start by understanding what the basic needs are. And we understand well needs around publishing, around accessing the literature, but increasingly I think we're going to need to understand the needs that researchers themselves have around the challenges that they're faced by the data that they're involved with. And so my three kind of buckets are researchers who work with data at scale, but they're all over it, and they totally have that nailed, and they're good to go. That's fine. Researchers who deal with the long tail of data that is not big data, and then the really interesting bucket for me is the bucket of researchers who woke up one morning recently and suddenly realized they've got loads of data and they have no idea what they're going to do with it. So the first group include fields like astronomy, high-energy particle physics, genomics. And what these fields have in common is they've been working with large data for a very long time, and they have good working international collaborations, good infrastructure for the maintenance, curation, sharing, and collaboration of that data, and extremely well-defined standards for how to locate the data and describe it. But even there, particularly when you look at high-energy particle physics, something like CERN is generating like 200 petabytes of data on a yearly basis with an intention for that to grow. It's still only about a third of what Facebook generates per year, actually, which is interesting. But when they're getting the data off their instrument, it's coming out at such high velocity when you have one of these collision events that it's not physically possible for them to store all of that. It's just happening at too fast a rate. And so they have heuristics around which bits of the data are they going to keep, which are they going to throw away, how they look for events that might be interesting. And they have a kind of like four-step process for deciding ahead of time how they're going to deal with different parts of that data. And then they just throw away like 99.9% of their data and keep the interesting bits. In astronomy, in one field that I think is really fun, is gamma ray astrophysics. And they're scanning the sky for gamma ray bursts, which are little flashes of light. But they'll put the image into a buffer, and then then they'll keep that buffer for about 10 or 15 seconds. And they're basically looking at the sky 10 or 15 seconds ago. And if nothing interesting happened over the previous 10 or 15 seconds, the data is allowed to flow at the end of the buffer. But if something interesting did happen, their machine vision algorithms identified and then captured that data right there. And that way they don't have a whole night of high-resolution data of a patch of sky that isn't doing anything. So that's also quite interesting. But so those are fields that have their shit together, so to speak. Then there are the fields which have the long tail of data. And these are really this is where most data is generated, but it's not big data. This is the data under the desk problem, where and most of this is Excel. And I think that breaks into two subcategories. Fields where researchers have good international collaborations, good data standards, and they know what to do with that data, but it's not data at scale. Crystallography is a great example. Anyone who's taking crystal structures must deposit that crystal structure in the protein data bank, otherwise they can't get published. So it means there's a home for that data, and everyone in that field shares that data openly. But there is a vast number of fields where people are just making up their data on the fly. It's messy. They're writing custom Excel files, custom text files. They really don't know what they're doing. They put it in a hard drive. They go away. That data gets lost forever, and it sort of evaporates. And what we're seeing is, in the industry, people like Figshare, DataDrive, and Zenodo are trying to step up to encourage people to just put that heterogeneous data into those places. And I noticed this week that Zenodo's just upped its free data tier to 50 gigabytes. And Zenodo is backed on the CERN data store. And for Zenodo, it's like, give everyone 50 gigabytes compared to how much we're storing for CERN. That's like nothing. So that's already upping the levels. So those are the kind of the top end, the bottom end. But what's going on in this tier in the middle? That's, I think, the most interesting for me at the moment. These are tiers of research where the technical infrastructure has suddenly got to a tipping point where these fields are now generating terabytes of data on a daily or a weekly basis, and they didn't realize that would happen. They didn't plan for it, and they're now swamped in data. And I'll give you a couple of examples. High-throughput microscopy in life sciences, where you just have a microscope that is looking at a field of cells evolving over a few hours. One of these machines will cost considerably more than a postdoc. So what you do is you buy that machine, you put it in the corner of your lab, and you hire postdocs at a cheaper rate to run the machine 24 hours a day while you're doing the course of your experiment. And it is generating extremely high-resolution images, and it will generate 15, 20 terabytes of data in a week. And that's all stored in disks under the machine for a while. And up to a point, that's OK, but how do you publish that? How do you share that with colleagues? You can't transmit it over the wire. It's too slow. You don't have a long-term preservation strategy. There's no agreed way for storing that data the funding isn't there for the kinds of infrastructures that store particle data or genomics data. Another really nice example is kinetomics, where you take brain slices, you freeze a brain, and you take like nanometer slices, and then you try and identify the cells through each slice of the brain, and then you can recreate the three-dimensional structure of the neural network of that brain. But the images, again, are creating terabytes of data. But here we have an interesting aspect. The network structure is considerably smaller in terms of data footprint than the image data. But then there's a question that maybe the image data is also capturing information about those cells that might be of interest to researchers that aren't the pure kinetomics researchers. And people just don't really know what to do with that data either. Now, you look at this in light of increasing requirements coming from funders to make your data available. And now you have people who have unpublishable data because it's too big, a requirement to make that data available, unclear decisions about what to do with data preservation, and I think these are fields that are currently experiencing like a mini data crisis. And I certainly would put the computational social sciences into the same bucket as well. Mm. And so that's sort of what's happening on the research side in those kind of three tiers. Mm-hmm. I think a couple of things that are beginning to impinge on the machine learning side that affect researchers, just some things I've noticed in the last couple of weeks. People are starting to use machine learning to scan the literature or to scan data coming from experiments to find new hypotheses. So there's a researcher at MIT, and they called Victor Pancratius, and they tie a machine learning algorithm to seismic sensors that are looking at events that are happening in volcanic or subduction zones, and they've been able to extract signals from these sensors that humans weren't able to observe and create new hypotheses about the structure of the lava flows that are happening underneath the ground that were beyond the theoretical capability of the actual researchers to do. That's really interesting. Another example is Chris Hartknick, who recently ran a machine learning algorithm over 600,000 psychology papers to do a peer review of the statistical methods in those papers. And my understanding is over the next couple of weeks, they're going to be posting the results of each of those analyses to PubPeer, saying whether this particular paper used the correct statistical method or whether it didn't. And that's being done in an autonomous way.
Let's hope Retraction Watch has a nice big storage system.
So some of those questions are then, what do I do with data that's getting to the point where no one's supporting me for it, but I need to be able to publish it? What are my strategies around which data I keep and which ones I throw away? How do we collaborate around data that I'm collecting that isn't core to my research but might be interesting to other people if we can connect them to the fact that I have that data? What do I do about the research mandates from funders? What are the implications of more advanced forms of big data analytics, particularly the machine learning analytics rather than just the number crunching analytics, on the underlying way that I do science or the underlying way that I'm assessed around my research outputs? And we don't have answers to most of those questions at the moment. But they are clear needs in the market from researchers right now.
A rich diet.
Yeah.
I can see references to food quite a lot and how people are hungry to eat. These kinds of chunks of information. Fran, do you have any thoughts on what Ian was covering?
Yeah, so the peer reviewing question is an interesting one. So if you peer review with machine learning, I can see that being effective at scale in some ways, but there is that classic slippery slope that you're going to get there where your algorithm is probably going to be pretty good, but it's going to encode correct as being standard. So any research that does things in an unusual way may start getting flagged as incorrect in a peer review sense, and that's one of those sort of unfortunate side effects of use of machine learning.
When I was at eLife, we did a test with a company called Meta.com, who have tried to do a predictive analysis of a paper. And so their pitch is, you give us a paper before it's published, and we'll look at one of 500 different signals or 150 different signals, and we'll tell you how many citations that paper is going to get in the next 10 years, and therefore let you know ahead of time which journal you should publish that paper in. But I suspect that it's predicting mostly on things like institution, on keywords, co-authorship, which are all kind of predictors of the past rather than the future. And we actually took a few of these reports and we tried to run them by some of our scientific editors at eLife and say, what do you think? Would this be helpful? And our editors hated it because they hated the idea that something would try and usurp their position of expertise in their understanding of the underlying content.
There's a couple of things there, though. So if you've got that kind of algorithm and your purpose as an organization is to optimize for citations, I bet you that algorithm does really well at it.
Yeah.
But if that's not your whole purpose as an organization, if your purpose is also to not miss the original important ones, mm-hmm. then you have a problem if you only use an algorithm.
Yeah.
And that's a real tension. And by the way, we come across that pattern of experts hating algorithms being involved at all in every industry.
How do you mitigate against that?
It's usually working with them to frame the problems and working with them to understand which parts of their jobs can safely be supported by algorithms and where the thing is that could go wrong. So where is it, you know, if there is an issue that you could have some crazy original paper which is really important to catch, how do we build an algorithm which lets the experts check ones which might be those?
Yeah.
So how do we take out the massive papers which might be terrible confidently and let the experts focus on the things which might be interesting? And it's about collaborating with them and making them understand that we're not trying to do their jobs, because computers can do brilliant things, but and they can go across scales of data and work that humans can't, but they're actually a lot stupider than humans in many elements and will continue to be for a long time.
That point you make about getting the right problem in front of the algorithm is an interesting one, and it reminds me of a project that's going on currently at BMC Biomed Central. They're attempting to implement a tool called Stats Checker. I can't remember who the tool is from, but they have a particular kind of publication, which is a report on, I think it's a reports on trials. And those trial reports, clinical trial reports, have minimum metadata requirements that need to be filled out. So you need to know that it's registered, you need to know whether it has ethical approval, and all of that comes in as part of the submission. And part of the editorial workflow is to just do a pure mechanical check to make sure that those things are in order. Mm-hmm. And so Stat Checker just takes the heavy lifting, and it doesn't tell you whether the underlying content is good or bad, but it tells you whether the submitted item has met those requirements and will immediately flag up whether it's not. So the goal there is to try and take some of the schlep out of the process of what's already happening. And the last time, Daniel Shanahan from Biomed Central was leading up the BMC side of that project. I talked to him about it probably 2 months ago, and they'd, at that stage, worked on the product for about a year and had got to the point where the first 10 or so manuscripts had actually gone through production with it. And I know they're planning to scale it up, but I haven't heard back about how that's going. But I think it's a much more appropriate form of getting the machines to do our dirty work for us rather than trying to do this other kind of work.
Yeah.
We're sort of at the end of that section, so I just wanted to check again if anyone's got any questions or thoughts on the way research is responding to big data. Anyone have any? Yeah, I see some hands, but can you who's first? So there's one over there. Can't really see very well, sorry, but why don't you go first and then I'll move on. Yep.
So I was really excited to hear you talking about peer review, because on the Scholarly Kitchen, we're doing a post tomorrow on the future of peer review, and I was kind of afraid. I went last and went out on a limb and said, well, why don't we give all the world's knowledge to Watson? And why don't we basically, and I was trying to make people kind of think out of the box, but why don't we then take that and come out with some kind of report or some kind of that, you know, develop to figure out if methods were correct, to figure out things that are more standard, and then you have a human look at that or even interact with that system to ask it questions, because the questions, I think, getting to your point, are so important, because you don't want to just knock things out. And I wasn't being serious, but but actually listening to you, I'm becoming more serious because it just seems like, just like everything else, why don't you take some of the repeatable, predictable kind of, and I don't want to call it drudgery, but if it's validating the validity of a data set, it might very well be that, you know, and give people the more interesting stuff to do.
Respond, anyone?
Yeah, I mean, I'm not sure if that was a question, but yeah, that makes a lot of sense as a statement. Yeah, indeed, these kinds of techniques and approaches are brilliant, as Ian said, taking out the schlep, and they can take out more and more of the schlep nowadays, but you always have to think critically about where could this also go wrong.
Yeah, what is human judgment?
I'm terrible at selling this.
Yeah, so I don't know. This researcher that I talked to, that I talked about earlier, who does this work on volcanology and on seismographs, his actual core expertise is on getting machines to create hypotheses and try to generate new knowledge. And I had the great pleasure of meeting him a few weeks ago. And I asked him, why don't you apply that to the textual literature and try and create hypotheses from that? Because I'd heard that a few years ago, some people had done something similar in some very constrained disciplines. And he said the problem right now is, even though the scholarly literature has a reasonable level of consistency in its formats, the way concepts and ideas are described in them remains well beyond the reach of their algorithms to make those kinds of insights and analyses. And so when they're looking at taking data from a sensing device, it is clearly understandable, it's unambiguous. But when you try and think about the task you've described, there's so much interpretation there. And I would say as well, yeah, you might be able to break that peer review into the functional aspects, as BMC are trying to do. But the interesting question is, can these machines help with the non-functional aspects? But there, the risks are so high for the people who would be undergoing those judgments, the underlying researchers, that question of whether they get their paper in or not is a massive risk, because a resubmission or a rework of a paper could take another 12 to 18 months. And if you're in a particular moment in your career, that can make or break your career. So right now, I would say it would be unethical and inappropriate to do that. But at what point does it become tractable? I don't know the answer, but it's one that, for sure, I guarantee you, startups like Meta.com and other startups are going to be going after, and they're going to be, you're probably all going to be getting in the next 2 years or so phone calls from these startups with that answer about how to algorithmize the peer review process and so forth. And
also, part of your worry is handled by thinking about precision versus recall, or type 1 versus type 2 errors, as they're called, or false positives and false negatives. Yeah. So you're saying it would be terrible to accidentally say someone's paper is incorrect method when it's actually correct. So then you build that into your thinking about the algorithm. You say, okay, this algorithm should only say something is incorrect if it's absolutely slam dunk incorrect. And if it might be correct, you put it to a human.
I think what I'm thinking about more, though, is that when you look at the peer review process in a journal, it's more of a social judgment than a judgment on the correctness. And so journals have evolved what they tend to call the bar for whether a thing gets into this journal.
Is the bar consistent and fair by people?
The bar is inconsistent and unfair when it's run by people, but it's also, by its nature of not being describable, difficult to encodify in an algorithm. And that's a challenge.
I think it varies sector by sector as well, and the kind of problem domain you're looking at, and there are areas which are, you know, what they call paradigm high, where there's very high agreement about what the sort of terms of reference are, what constitutes an adequate knowledge claim, in which, for example, journals have very low rejection rates because the only people who go in the first place don't need a lot more than basic polishing. They already work at CERN. They've already got, they're pre-qualified. Whereas when you're at the other end of the spectrum, which is the one we'll come to in a minute, at social research, let's say, which is paradigm low, then the mature judgment of peers with all the unfairnesses built into that seems very hard to replace. And when there was this report published last year, The Metric Tide was trying to look at whether you could look an alternative to the REF process, dependent on expert peer review, and find some alternative using other kinds of measures available. There were whole areas in paradigm low fields where the correlation between what the metrics would suggest was high quality research and what the peer review does was massively divergent. And so I think a lot of these approaches need to come down to what works best in which kind of setting, which does take us more to social research now. But I think before we go into that, there was another hand or two over here, and I missed it. So actually there are three. So let's hear from you.
Working with big data analytics and machine learning for scholarly publishers. Regarding your comment on algorithmizing peer review or predicting citations, I have a background in financial economics, and there is a thing in algorithmic trading that if you're trying to determine by an algorithm which is a good stock using certain factors in that algorithm, and if a lot of people start trading using those factors, they diminish the excessive returns out of that, and so that algorithm is no longer any good. Similarly, if you apply the same concept to peer review or predicting citations, if researchers are aware, you know, eventually everybody would know what those factors are, a good institution, probably a good previous citation record, and so on. So people would try to, I think, you know, just meet that criteria and get past that algorithm and get their paper published. So it would eventually defeat the purpose, and that's my view on it, but I would like to hear your comment on it, especially on this aspect.
So if you're in something like high-frequency trading, I don't know much about it, but that's not going to stop me having an opinion. one of the aspects of that is you can change your trading strategy fairly quickly, hour to hour maybe even. And so the rate at which the whole system can feed back to the predictive algorithms is pretty high. And so you can probably get numb to the algorithmic efficiency pretty quickly. But if we talk about these signals in scholarly publishing that get you past that quote-unquote bar, one of them might be being in Harvard. Now, it's going to take a very long time for everyone who figures that's the signal out to get into Harvard because it's capacity limited. And so I'm not saying that's fair, but I'm saying I think that the way that you might imagine the system in scholarly publishing might self-correct is intrinsically resistant to some of those changes because of capacity limitations around some of the signals. I think the way to attempt to deal with it is to modify the way peer review is done. And that is a discussion that probably sits outside of the discussion around big data that we're having here. But things like experimenting with blind, double-blind reviews, doing consultative peer review, doing review by panel where you look not only at the paper but at impact statements from researchers, these all seem to have the potential to try and break some of that deadlock. But the journals system needs to be proactive about going out and realizing that there are some significant biases that happen, particularly gender biases are very clear to demonstrate through looking at literature reviews.
There was another hand somewhere. Yeah, right at the very back.
This is Richard Wynn from Aries Systems. I have an advertisement, a comment, and a question. So we're in the peer review system business, and we integrate a lot of these tools. We've integrated the meta tool so that it's on offer to editors during peer review, and we're also talking to Stat Reviewer, who are the statistical checking engine that I believe was mentioned.
Oh, cool.
We have thought a lot about how to market this product, and we've come to the conclusion that decision assist is really the right thing. So we're not replacing what editors do, we're assisting them pretty much in the same way that we do with the iAuthenticate plagiarism check and other reference checking tools. My question is, how are we going to get publishers to pay for this? Because editor time is essentially free to publishers. And we really struggle as we bring along these tools and they solve a very real problem, but there's no economic model to sort of feed the beast with more resources, because no one actually wants to pay to save editors' time. And in fact, often these tools, you know, especially with Authenticate, actually causes more use of time by editors. So that's my question.
Have you tried cultivating the need in the editors themselves so they put pressure on the publishers?
I think I'd have to run out of the room if I suggested that I was going to talk to any of the publishers' editors here. They would just chase me.
I suspect that's the answer to your question, though. I think we should probably move us now on to the social research piece, and then we can come back to the sort of publishing industry more generally and pick up, you know, various of the questions that have threaded through the discussion so far. On the social research side, you know, we at Sage have been very interested in this for some good time, but it's been there are sort of one or two really nice examples of social research done on a scale never seen before that have definitely got my attention over the last year or two, but which are also contrasted with so many kind of failed efforts or lots of questions and hand-wringing that's going on within social research. So I'll mention at least one of these examples. There's a sociologist at Berkeley called Nick Adams, who is interested in social protest movements, and in particular where they turn violent, where some incident happens between protesters and police and things kick off. And those sort of social movement theories have been sort of abounded in the social sciences for a long, long time. But have usually tended to center where they've been done empirically on one particular case. Well, what Nick did instead was look at the phenomenon of the Occupy movement in the US across 192 cities. I don't know how many Occupy events happened across those, but you can imagine. And then looked at the different kinds of reports being done, whether it's police reports, eyewitness reports, journalistic accounts, national news, you name it, and built up this enormous corpus of text describing what was going on across those 192 cities. And on one level, it's a tractable problem in the sense that if you've done good old-fashioned content analysis to code what was going on in this stuff, it could have been done. It just would have taken a lot of people a lot of time. So what he came up with is an alternative which used a combination of crowdsourcing using people like Mechanical Turk and Crowdflower, and before getting the crowd involved, they did some first cut analysis to define what the situations were and so on, to make it more sort of, so they could easily train the crowd workers. But the crowd workers would also generate effectively training sets that the machine learning algorithm could also then work with to then potentially augment or replace some of the work of the, you know, the coding analysis that the crowd workers were doing. And one way or another, they've managed to do this coding of this entire corpus now within 1 year. Nick was saying at least 15 years was a more, sort of more likely time frame to have been done in traditional ways. And he's now publishing out the discoveries he's making. He's finding out that police operate in a much more strategic way than people used to think, and the way they arrest people, how showy it is and how many individuals it is, depends a lot on whether there's an election in the offing and so on. So he's finding patterns that I don't think would have been available to him beforehand. The other example, which is very nice, it's a very contained but powerful piece of work by Gary King, who's a political scientist at Harvard University, who, as he describes it, was reverse engineering Chinese censorship. And he said there are 200,000 censors at work in China, and he's saying, you know, this work they're doing is the kind of single largest selective suppression of human expression in human history, and he would like to understand what criteria they're applying. And in order to do so, in particular, he's interested in social media censorship. So in order to do that, he essentially grabbed 13 million blogs and cached them all, and could in real time watch when the censors were stepping in to take them down, and then be able to compare what he had and what. And so as the blog came up, he would capture it, then they would, then he'd watch the ones get taken down. About 13% of that 13 million over whatever the time period was were taken down. And what he discovered was the criteria being applied wasn't criticism of the government, as you might expect. It wasn't people sort of ranting on about things. The thing that triggered the censors to act was any call to action, any attempt to mobilize. Even if it was good news, even if it was supportive of the government, even if people were on the blog saying, oh, fantastic, Ai Weiwei has been arrested, let's go and have a party to celebrate the wisdom of our government, that would be taken down too. So criticism was fine, calls to action, whether positive or negative, not fine. And then the only counterpoint being that if you were critical of the censors, that in itself would be taken down. So this kind of beautiful work, which he's published out in the American Political Science Review, has really shown, I think, the potential for asking certain new kinds of questions and old, and finding better ways to answer them. And what I love about that particular example is that, unlike most of social science, where you are trying to sort of approximate or represent a part of the phenomenon you're describing, in his case, he just got his arms around the whole thing. It sort of reminds me of that Borges short story of inexactitude in science, where the perfect map is the thing that it, which has a ratio of the thing to which it is mapping of 1:1, and it almost has that kind of quality to it. But when you do look at examples of sort of large scale social research, you do quickly come a cropper in lots of ways. And Susan Fiske and a bunch of psychologists at Princeton and Cornell came a real cropper when they did their work with Facebook a couple of years ago, a story that you may have followed, where working with the developers at Facebook were tweaking the messages people received on a sort of sentiment, either positive or negatively, to see then if that influenced the kinds of posting people would do and create a sort of mini social contagion. And they were able to get data from 650,000 people and indeed found that effect. But they really ended up in dicey terrain because they were failing on the standard of informed consent. Well, Facebook didn't have that worry. We've all signed a 13,000-page document selling our soul, our children, and all our chances of future happiness to Facebook as and wish they would like to use it, including the right to be experimented on. So Facebook themselves could have done it. But actually, once the psychologists tried to do it, they fell foul of ethics committees, which had a different threshold of what constitutes informed consent. And that has in itself triggered a massive debate within social research about whether that needs to be weakened now in the light of the kind of data that are available, and rather than just hamstringing the social researchers. Social researchers, therefore, are coming to it a bit more slowly, a bit more cautiously, and in a mixed bag. They're up against a number of other factors as well. They're up against the fact that they need to, not only do they have to have informed consent and other ethical concerns, they also need to make sure that they're not doing sampling bias and all sorts of traditional methodological concerns, but ones that don't necessarily worry, let's say, a marketer in a big tech company. For a researcher studying social inequality, the people who've fallen off the digital grid are extremely important if you're going to get a picture of what it is you're trying to describe. That's not the case if you're trying to sell hats. And so they're kind of working their way through this. So we've done a massive survey at Sage, and we've had so far, I think, close to 13,000 social researchers coming back, and they're surfacing up all sorts of issues and challenges to what would enable them to do this sort of data-intensive computational social science. And it's not just those kinds of methodological and ethical concerns, it's also technical ones. It's about the fact that they aren't trained in terms of being able to handle the kind of the technology and the software, or indeed they don't typically have sort of access across their discipline silos to experts who can help them. So the work of people that I've mentioned, Nick Adams and Gary King, both happened in interdisciplinary centers with collaborative labs where social researchers would mix with computational linguists, would mix with computer scientists to actually do this work, which a sociology department couldn't do on its own. Well, that's, as we know, not how research is currently organized. So there are many kinds of hurdles and barriers. And yet, it does feel like it's an incredibly important and exciting thing to make headway on. So we're definitely spending a lot of time on sort of trying to sort of crack our heads on moving this question of computational social science along. But I think it's it's almost like the last bastion on this sort of research spectrum that Ian was describing, and yet in some ways the most profoundly important. Mm-hmm. You know, in terms of going back to human values, going back to what it is that we care about in a deliberative democracy, and how our lives can go well, we need to be able to get a way back into ancient questions, and we need to mobilize this community to enable them to help go beyond just description and prediction, but into explanation and historical accounting. So that's a lot of, you know, what's been exciting us at Sage, and I think is very exciting more generally. Any thoughts from either of you on those?
I wanted to give another anecdote. Well, not an anecdote. It's from a researcher called Hannah Wallach, who is a computational social scientist, and herself and one of her research partners submitted freedom of information requests to every district in some state in America. I can't remember which state it is. For all public emails from each of those districts for a random period of time. And these districts had an equivalent Freedom of Information Act, so they were compelled to release that data. And they were obliged to depersonalize some of the data, but any of the transactional data around government, local government, must be made available. They got 500 million emails from 23 of the districts, and they were able to do some really interesting analysis. And they were initially going to publish the data because the data was obtained via Freedom of Information Acts. It is public data. It would be completely legal to do so. But when they inspected the data, they realized that several of these districts just didn't do a very good job of cleaning the data. So the data included social security numbers. It included personal emails. It included the addresses of the people who were actually involved. And so they realized very quickly is that there's a strong distinction between what is ethical behavior with some of these data sets and what is legal behavior with some of these data sets. And I think you have to be very sensitive to the fact that with these data sets, if you're talking about particle physics, a top quark doesn't care if you tell people what its color is. Yep. But the fundamental subject of these social science data sets are people and their human relations, and they need to be treated with respect and dignity and a whole different way that I think many of the other industries that are dealing with this data don't give that kind of credence to.
Yeah, I mean, the truth is, as you say, that in industry, many very unethical things are very much legal, and in things like, you know, consumer internet services, gambling being the really obvious example. If you're running an online gambling company, really the way you make money is to find the few people who are going to get hooked and gamble a lot and get them to gamble and gamble and gamble, and that's where the profit comes from. And part of doing that is building really good machine learning algorithms to catch them at the right moment when they're likely to spend most money. They've consented to their data being used, they're on the system, but it's clearly not ethical. And there are lots of more minor instances of that kind of thing. And then on the other hand, you've got what could be very good social research being blocked by lack of data. Lack of data access.
There's a huge debate going on about whether
mismatch in the harms and the benefits.
Could one sort of try and set up licenses with the big corporates to say that surely academics doing different kind of work could have availability to what is otherwise commercially sensitive and locked up data for them also to do this work. So any questions on that kind of area before we sort of wrap round to thinking about the industry more generally? There's a hand up there.
Mark Harden from Mosaic. I'm interested in following up on that sort of cost of data and ethics and risk of data, and you might explore that a bit more. Because you've talked a little bit about, you know, capturing all the data at Mendeley, that sort of thing, and also then about getting data on the freedom of information and then finding that it's full of confidential information. It hadn't been scrubbed properly, but of course the costs of scrubbing that are huge. And you know, I worked at a company once where they had a policy of deleting all email after 90 days, which I thought was crazy and inconvenient and all that. But they actually told me that there was a legal department issue, but actually around costs, where it wasn't that they were afraid of being subpoenaed and having to produce incriminating history, it was actually that it could cost them millions to provide the data under a subpoena, being able to go through it all and clean it up and select it and all that sort of thing. So, you know, this whole area of you know, data is good, data is interesting, there are potentially huge, huge costs in retaining and delivering up data. And, you know, where do you stand on deliberately destroying data to avoid those costs or those ethical issues?
That's a good pragmatic question on the trade-offs. That's a slight aside, but I'm thinking about the economist who said, there is an optimal amount of dust in my house and it's not zero. And that actually the sort of those trade-offs do have to kick in very quickly. And while it's on some level cheap just to hold on to stuff and have your rivers of sewage, whatever your metaphor was earlier, yeah. The idea of actually making it tractable and deliverable to someone who asks for it probably makes it easier just to burn it. So I wonder if either of you got views on sort of the pragmatism and sort of cost-benefit side of these questions.
It's complicated. I mean, it's complicated because of the legal landscape that these data may exist in and those kinds of requirements. And I don't think there's a clear answer. I did ask someone at Google if I could get access to all of their data to give to computational social scientists, and that person said no. And I was like, oh, go on. I was like, no. But then he explained very clearly a rationale that I hadn't considered. And he said that Google understands copyright law extraordinarily well because they operate in so many domains and jurisdictions. And they know with bulletproof certainty that serving search snippets on their corpus is allowed by that copyright law. But any other use of their search index, they don't know what the implications are. And as a result of that uncertainty, they are unwilling to look at other applications of it. And I thought that was a really insightful and interesting example. So I don't know if there are answers. I am intrigued by Apple's moves towards technology that they're calling differential privacy, where they want to apply machine learning algorithms to your data, but keep it local to your device, and find ways to extract insight, but that are algorithmically provably anonymized. That's the pitch. It's something I don't know much about, but certainly I know that Apple are starting to use that as a marketing tool. And so the industry has certainly moved in the direction of, let's get all the data, let's just use it whilst discarding these kinds of concerns. But there may be market reasons to increase the robustness of algorithms that work in these more provably opaque ways. And I think that's going to be an interesting trend in the next several years, but I don't know much about it.
And differential privacy is quite a big thing now for the big internet companies, although it's surprising how little demand for it there seems to be from consumers, but it is a big trend. But yeah, it's very easy to accidentally reveal personal data with the example from, I think it was about a year ago, the New York taxi cabs data. Mm-hmm. So New York City are big into open data, which generally can be quite a big public good. They decided to release all of the data on taxi journeys in the city over a time period for interesting research. So far, so good. Unfortunately, they made a bit of a boo-boo in the way that they released the data, because people found that they could match up things like photos of celebrities getting out of taxi cabs with medallion numbers and where people had come from and gone to, and found out lots of interesting things about where both famous people and other people had come from. So. Yeah. There was quite a clever takedown written of it where someone basically chose the location of a strip club, looked at taxi journeys from there to residential neighborhoods, and started to figure out patterns of movements of people who certainly seem to live in a particular house. So it's really easy to try and use data in some way that seems really innocuous. It's got nobody's names in it, seems very bland, and accidentally release data. So it's a scary, scary world as dealing with that kind of data, even though dealing with it can be very useful and powerful, you're always watching your back for those kinds of mistakes.
And indeed is why social research is going to be agonizing throughout this whole time, even indeed, as it moves, because unlike quarks, they care where they came from, they care where they're going, and who knows about it. We've just got a few minutes left, so we thought it'd just be good to get any views on, in light of what we've sort of talked about, but other things that you've been thinking about in relation to this set of topics that might be relevant to the industry generally, or whether it's from the point of view of individual companies. We talked a bit about that at the beginning, but any thoughts or questions anyone has about what these themes mean for scholarly publishing? Yeah. Is there a mic within reach?
Michael Jupp. An observation rather than a question. It seems to me that lots of the issues that you're talking about arise in the library sector too. There's increasing interest in looking at relationships between information use on the one hand and learning outcomes, learning analytics, teaching processes and outcomes, and also research outcomes. And of course those give rise to precisely some of the kinds of issues that have been touched on, like the skills and expertise that you need to be able to pose, let alone pose the questions, let alone do the analytics, but also a whole host of ethical issues as well. So it seems to me that there are issues for the publishing industry, but also for information consumers.
Yes, yeah, absolutely. Any other thoughts and questions? Enough's enough?
One down the left.
Oh, where's that? Sorry, I'm blinded by this spotlight.
Sorry, it's Mark Cartney. Just following up on Michael's comment about libraries, I mean, I think that is interesting, and I think libraries have traditionally been very strong on user confidentiality. And when I was in the library technology business, it was kind of interesting that people would say, well, why can Amazon recommend what I should buy next, but my library can't recommend what I should borrow next? And the answer was that Amazon had your personal data, and your library very deliberately didn't keep your personal data because they had a different attitude to privacy. And indeed, when I was working for a library vendor, the FBI couldn't believe that we didn't record library borrowings, and they actually came and looked at our code to see whether that was really true, which was fascinating. But obviously, that's the problem. There's this tension between confidentiality and privacy and the services that you can offer if you have that data. And I think probably libraries and academia and that kind of area is weak in that, because we're in a good way rather hesitant about confidentiality in the way that corporates are there.
And I wonder if those norms are going to start shifting. And I was alluding to it earlier in terms of how the social scientists are discussing this debate around informed consent. And we put on a lecture with the Campaign for Social Science at the end of last year. And Sharon Witherspoon, who used to run the Nuffield Foundation, was almost putting out a case and saying there are times to get over some of the scruples which made sense in a certain context. But now, with everyone racing by in a different way, it just looked like trying to line up in a queue and everyone's just run to the front. And actually it needs a different set of expectations, a different set of norms needs to be brought to bear. I'm sure that in itself, when she said it, it was a controversial claim, but I imagine those kinds of arguments are going to start emerging. Otherwise you're going to end up with this total divide between the sort of one set of ethical norms applying in a context which increasingly finds itself hard to be, struggling to be relevant compared to many other sectors. Any others? Final.
I guess I've got a final thought.
Yeah, do.
So that's been a really interesting conversation. Thank you. I really enjoyed that. But what we've seen is that there are definite researcher needs. We've seen that there are definite opportunities with these tools. We've seen that many of the landscapes are changing. But I want to ask a final question. Why should we as an industry care about any of this? And I think that comes down to an understanding of what our mission or our purpose is. And so a lot of what we do is content-based and transactional-based. But at our heart, we're about democratizing knowledge and about getting the right knowledge to the right people and about providing solutions around that knowledge. And how we do that is separate from what our mission is and what our purpose is as an industry. And I think if we look purely at that mission and purpose, then it gives us the freedom to reimagine how we might provide those services or best support scholarship and researchers. And you combine that realization with an understanding that all of the tools and technologies that we've been talking about today are rapidly becoming cheap to experiment with, rapidly becoming cheap to iterate with. And I think that leaves you with the inevitable conclusion that we should be experimenting with this stuff, even if we're not quite clear what those products and services are that will be created. But now is the time to start looking at it and to start thinking about it. And compared to the overall cost of operation of most of our organizations, starting to work with organizations like FRANS or starting to hire in a couple of people on some preliminary projects is a relatively low initial overhead compared to, I think, the potential benefits. Even if those benefits are simply understanding this landscape better and what its implications might be for yourself as a business.
It's an excellent rallying call for the industry on which to end. I've been enjoying the Twitter conversation along as well, so you've participated in lots of ways. Please join me in thanking Fran and Ian for such expert and interesting conversation.